I'm Jim Turner, and welcome to dLife TV Online. It's going to be a great show in a new place. We'll be here Sundays at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, with new shows about living your dLife. Every week, we'll be sharing insights, recipes from the dLife kitchen, stories about real people living and achieving with diabetes, and so much more. We're glad you're here. Now on with the show.
My name is Ben Graham. Now I'm a diabetic. I have type 2 diabetes. I work for the city of Chicago, and I get up in the morning, get ready, and hit the street. I didn't know that diabetes and kidney failure were like they're like hand in hand, so to speak. One will start the other to happening. Otherwise, I would have jumped on it seriously in 1992 when I first was diagnosed with it. I'd have changed my diet right away. Probably would have ate any more cookies and ice cream, and I would have went to the club more, would have dropped 20 pounds right away. A couple of years later, when things started getting worse, then I realized I got to take this thing seriously. I got to finally go on dialysis because I was at the lowest point that I could get to. My legs were swollen, my feet were swollen, couldn't get into my shoes. High blood pressure, impotence. You know, these are things that they don't tell you about, but when things start happening to your body that it's not working normally, you gotta get that checked out right away. So I kept saying, all right, I'm gonna try this a little longer to try and fight it off until I finally said, okay, set it up.
What's your goal, 5.5? You're on it for 4 hours.
Dialysis is a form of, it's like an artificial kidney in a sense. It acts and does the things that my kidney no longer does. You don't urinate the same, your body does not excrete the toxins that are in it, so once your kidney starts failing, you need this to live.
How you doing?
I come to dialysis after work.
Yeah. You got a permit?
Yeah, but I don't have it with me. I switched trucks.
Each session for myself is like 4 hours, 3 days a week. But if it means living, it's not a big deal, not a big choice to make. My doctors have, you know, your kidney is failing, and you might consider going on dialysis because eventually you will start feeling bad. And if you don't do it in time, you could die. My significant other supported me 100%, wanted to make sure that I was eating right, doing the right things, that I followed up on all the stuff that my physician said that I should do, and I should get in here as soon as I could to take care of this and also pursue a transplant. They ask for a lot of tests before you can even be put on the list, so they're not just giving you a kidney because you need one. Most of the transplant centers also want you to be in pretty good general, overall, good condition and everything else. Mikey, I think my blood pressure is getting a little low.
Is it?
The 113.
Is it?
Yeah, I don't want to have a scene here, so maybe shoot me 100. I'm very active. I question things, I ask questions, I find out, I have them explain everything to me because I want to know what's going on. A dialysis patient has to help themselves too. When they give you your labs back, which they check once a month, and they show you what's high or what's low, what you need to do, you got to get this down, you got to take care of that. And you realize you still have a chance to straighten things out and still have a pretty good life. And you start realizing how important life really is, and you got to do something.
I'm Chef Michel Nishan, and welcome to the dLife Kitchen. Today we're gonna cook a delicious winter squash soup. Now when most folks go to a restaurant and they order soup, they think they're doing something healthy, but they really don't know just how many carbs and how much fat can be in that recipe. A lot of soups are thickened with flour or cornstarch, and they often contain things like potatoes, pasta, and cream and butter in abandon. Today, we're gonna use nature's best winter vegetable to make a really creamy soup. It's awesome, let's get started. What I have here some butternut squash. I love butternut squash because it's kind of tastes like sweet potatoes, but it doesn't have the carbs. It also purees beautifully. Now, what I like to use is a little bit of grapeseed oil. We're going to add the shallots and the garlic. And you can see that I have the pan just hot over a medium flame. And I'm going to stir these around and let them cook until they become fragrant and a little bit translucent. Here I have my nice dried rosemary. I'm going to add that. And then fresh thyme. And now we're ready for the butternut squash. And you can see this beautiful orange color of the squash is going to come through in the finished product. It's just going to be a beautiful soup. What we're going to do is take this raw squash and toss it until it's well coated with the oil. It's going to pick up all of the flavor from the herbs. And then we're going to add some store-bought low-sodium vegetable stock. So what I do is I put a lid on, increase the simmer, and then just let it cook 15 to 20 minutes, or just until the squash is soft. Now here, we have some that's been cooking about 15 or 20 minutes. The squash is really tender. Now we're going to move over to the blender and puree the squash into a beautiful, smooth soup. There we go. And there you have it, beautiful, smooth butternut squash soup. Now I'm just going to thin it out with a little bit of non-fat milk. And if you think it's going to be a little bit too thick or you need to thin it out, just a little more veg stock at the end. We're just going to puree it in a couple of seconds. Voila, it's soup. And look at that, that's just gorgeous. Now here, check this out, look at the color. That is beautiful. Now what I like to do is take a little bit of non-fat sour cream and bring just a little bit of tanginess in at the end. Now that is a great winter squash soup. I'm Michelle Nishan. Thanks for joining us in the dLife Kitchen, and come back soon to get some more great low-carb recipes and tips.
As a most celebrated and learned person who is also pancreatically challenged, I am invited to many dinner parties to share my vast knowledge and my sparkling conversation. He has diabetes. His pancreas doesn't make insulin. I can't speak for his conversational skills. I'm a stickler for ensuring that my basal rates are always perfect. And prior to a dinner of duck a l'orange, I administer a subterranean injection of the precise bolus dose. No, he's not going underground. What he means is subcutaneous, which is another word for injecting insulin under the skin into the tissue. Bolus is a dose of fast-acting insulin given to cover an expected rise in blood glucose, such as before a meal. And his perfect basal rates are small amounts of longer-acting insulin. After we retire to the library for a spot of brandy and dessert, I always ask my adoring host to show me the dessert labels. And I am relieved to find that neither have sugar. The creme brulee has dextrose, and the cherries jubilee has fructose. What Mr. Know-It-All doesn't know is that dextrose and fructose are sugar, just like lactose, sucrose, and glucose. The language of diabetes has many different words for sugar and carbs, and all of them can raise your blood sugar. After bidding adieu to my admirers, James drives me home and Chaz turns down my bed so that I can have a peaceful slumber of perfect diabetes control with no ketoacidosis and awaken to another phenomenal dawn. Ketoacidosis, or DKA, happens when very high blood sugars result in ketones in the urine and can cause symptoms like nausea and vomiting and sometimes total loss of consciousness. And I think the genius means dawn phenomena, phenomenal dawn. Those high morning blood sugars caused by hormonal changes during sleep, which is really nothing to look forward to. Diabetes jargon can be confusing, even for the best of us. Islets, C-peptides, glucagon, microalbumin. Sometimes it feels like you need a PhD to understand or manage this disease. But no one knows it all. Not even this guy. You know, if you ask your doctor questions, listen to the answers, and educate yourself, good control won't get lost in translation. And that's a language we can all understand.
Really, a dog with diabetes can live a normal lifespan and really be very comfortable and happy pet for the rest of their life.
So I was very surprised, and I was very nervous and a little scared. I mean, I had never given a syringe in my life. I didn't know how to do it.
Just like for human diabetes, we want to try to control the blood sugar as well as we can during the day. She's really a type 1 diabetic, so she will require insulin the rest of her life. You are such
not
nothing at all.
You know, I'll do anything for my dog, so as long as she's healthy.
When you first brought PuttaCat to me, he was diabetic,
oh,
right?
Oh, yes.
Yes, and he was drinking lots of water.
Lots of water, and we started your miracle cure.
We call it the Catkins diet, but just the concept of looking for foods that are lower in carbohydrate and higher in protein and fat, because that's more like what the cat's normal diet would be. He was able to maintain himself without the insulin for the last 4 years. If you eat a diet that is right for your body and right for your type of genetics, you know, what you were designed to eat in the first place, then you're not going to have the problems with diabetes that you would if you don't.
That's the show for today. Thanks for tuning in. I know I learned a lot, and I want to know what you think. So be sure to share your thoughts in the comments below, and I'll see you here next Sunday, 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, for another exciting episode of dLife TV Online.